to audience questions now, and Sarah, I'll let you start us on one of the cards, and if you'd like to actually call an audience member to come up, and they can come up while you're reading a card. So if there's folks in the audience that would like to ask a question, they can let Sarah know. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so on one of the cards it says, can you compare the reach of the JTTF under these current assessments to the reach and direction or focus of COINTELPRO of an earlier time?
As I sort of mentioned, under J. Edgar Hoover, the FBI had claimed the authority to act in the realm of national security without a rule book. There was no written down rules of the road. And so they were basically investigating anybody they chose to investigate. The guidelines were put in place initially to require that reasonable suspicion of illegal activity, and because they weren't statutory, it was just attorney general guidelines, every attorney general would change. So they were incrementally changed here and there, and they sort of got a little bit weaker under one attorney general, and then there would be a scandal. You might remember the CISPIS scandal, the Committee in Solidarity with the People of El Salvador, where the FBI was spying on this group of nuns. After that, it sort of came back, and it was sort of an ebb and a flow, but stuck around this idea of a reasonable indication of criminal activity until 9/11 is when it really started eroding seriously, and then 2008, when McCasey, Attorney General Michael McCasey, created the existing guidelines, which now are basically back to where J. Edgar Hoover was, where the FBI can choose to investigate whoever they want to based on their own authority and engage in all kinds of behavior like using informants and otherwise doing things that might actually harm somebody's life where there's no forum. It's not like, the situation you were in, Brandon, where you're charging somebody or holding somebody under a material support order. It's not like you have a forum to defend yourself, right? It's just the FBI taking action. You can't say you're innocent because there's no place for you to say that. It creates this conundrum, and that's where we are today, where there are all kinds of people who find themselves continually harassed, including here in Portland. There was one case that hasn't come up. There was a May Day protest in Seattle in 2012 where some windows got broken, which is sad for the people whose windows they were. But I wouldn't call that terrorism, but the Joint Terrorism Task Force got involved and had in fact been surveilling anarchists, so-called anarchists, what the FBI called anarchists, here in Portland, including some who did not go to the protests. So we're not there, we're not suspected of being involved in breaking the courthouse window, but the FBI used the pretext of the fact that they broke a federal courthouse window as a federal crime to conduct armed raids and similar to what we're hearing. What they're collecting is anarchist literature, signs, black clothing. You know, I looked at those search warrants, and they weren't looking for explosive devices. They weren't looking for illegal weapons. They weren't looking for any weapons. You know, it was literally literature that they were looking for. But they also used the grand jury, which is a very powerful tool for investigation. And when these activists, again, were not there, have no information about who broke the window, realized that the grand jury was going to be used to get them to expand on who were their friends and who else was involved in the political movement, so they chose not to participate and went to jail, and were put in jail for months. I think 6 months was the longest before the judge finally determined that they weren't going to speak and they let them go. Turns out that they knew who broke the window. They arrested him that day, and he had pled guilty, and wasn't part of any organized anarchist group and was sentenced to 2 months in jail. So the guy who actually did it went to jail for less time than people who weren't actually there. And I believe that this is part of an effort like COINTELPRO to suppress political activity. They don't like this political activity. It's unruly. It's messy. So it's easier to try it to create a cost. You might know, I don't know, is anybody following the J20? You know what that is? January 20th, the day after the inauguration, a big protest in D.C. And again, some windows got broken. Somebody lit a limo on fire. Some garbage cans got lit on fire. Again, you know, I have no problem with the police enforcing those laws and doing that, but the police used this technique called kettling, where they took these big nets and they wrapped up pretty much everybody in the area and charged 200 protesters with felonies. And those trials are still going on. The first set of trials, luckily, ended in acquittals, but the federal government is trying to create a cost to protest. And, you know, it's shocking to me that you see that kind of aggressive over policing like you've seen in Ferguson, like you've seen at Standing Rock, and yet you see these other protests where white nationalists